In today's video, I'm going to talk about Dr. Pimentel's recent SIBO discoveries and what they mean for you and your IBS, so stay tuned. If you're new here, welcome. My name is Amanda Malicheski. I'm a certified functional nutrition health coach and a digestive and allergy detective. For weekly videos on how to make sense of the diet and supplement advice for IBS and SIBO, please consider subscribing and be sure to hit the bell to be notified when I post a new video. In the last several years, Dr. Mark Pimentel of the Pimentel Lab at Cedars-Sinai in Los Angeles, California, has revolutionized our understanding of the condition we call SIBO, or small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. And so because I rely on the most up-to-date information as I coach my IBS and SIBO clients, I wanted to take a few minutes to share some of these really interesting discoveries with all of you so that you can use them to make better decisions about your IBS and SIBO. So let's get started. Discovery number one is that the microbiome of the small intestine is far different than previously imagined. The first really important discovery that Dr. Pimentel and his team have found is that they've identified clearly the actual individual organisms that are responsible for the overgrowth in the small intestine. In 2020, they released the results from their Reimagine study, and they showed that two particular organisms, E. coli and another type of bacteria called Klebsiella, are responsible for SIBO. They are the overgrown bacteria in the condition. And they also showed that an overgrowth of these bacteria are correlated with positive SIBO breath tests by lactulose. And in addition to these two pieces, they also showed that there's not really a correlation between the microbiome in the small intestine and the microbiome in the large intestine. So what does this mean for you? Well, first of all, it means that the lactulose breath test that's widely used for diagnosing SIBO is pretty accurate. And if it's positive, it has a high correlation with the actual overgrowth of these specific bacteria. So that's helpful to know. Secondly, it means that SIBO symptoms are often being directly caused by an actual infection with a specific organism. And this is great news because it means that it's treatable. So this is really important information to know. And finally, it means that you can't really use stool test results to infer that you have SIBO because the microbiome, again, in the small intestine and large intestine are different. So I've seen a lot of people in forums and even heard from people that have said their practitioner has said, oh, well, it looks like you might have SIBO based on the stool test result. And because of Dr. Pimentel's research, we know that this isn't really true. Number two is that Dr. Pimentel's team has determined that food poisoning is one of the most significant and most common triggers of SIBO. If you've had a case of food poisoning and you feel like your gut has never been the same since that episode, you're not crazy. You actually probably have SIBO. Dr. Pimentel says that getting food poisoning from organisms like Shigella or E. coli or Salmonella or Campylobacter or other kinds of bacteria can lead to elevated levels of something called cytolethal distending toxin, which is abbreviated as CDTB. And this elevated level of toxin that is emitted by these bacteria that infest your gut when you have food poisoning can actually damage something called vinculin by creating anti-vinculin antibodies. Vinculin is partly responsible for keeping the nerves in your gut functioning normally, which helps your gut move at a normal pace. This drives the normal cleaning waves of your gut called the migrating motor complex and, you know, is basically regulating the speed with which food and other material moves through your digestive system. So when the anti-vinculin antibodies damage vinculin on your gut nerves, this can slow down the transit time in your gut. And it's this slowing down of the gut that leads to the bacterial overgrowth with, again, E. coli and Klebsiella. And elevations of these two lab markers, the CDTB and the anti-vinculin antibodies, usually correlate with abdominal pain and diarrhea symptoms. So this is primarily high in IBS-D situations. And this also means that SIBO cases triggered by these antibodies are actually an autoimmune condition. The good news is that Dr. Pimentel and his team are working on treatments to try and address these issues directly. But in the meantime, he's developed a test called IBS Check, which you can use to check for elevations of the CDTB or the anti-vinculin antibodies. You just have to request it from your doctor. It's a simple blood test, and Dr. Pimentel says that if you're positive for both of these markers, it's basically 98% sure that you have IBS as opposed to other kinds of digestive challenges like IBD or Crohn's disease or celiac disease or any manner of other digestive problem. So this is a really simple option to pursue with your doctor if you have unremitting diarrhea type IBS, especially if your symptoms began after a bout of food poisoning. And by the way, you don't even have to remember the episode of food poisoning. You could have mild food poisoning or food poisoning that you almost didn't even notice and still develop these antibodies, which is super frustrating. But just thought I'd say that in case you're like, well, I've never had food poisoning. If you have unremittent diarrhea and you've been unable to figure out what's going on, this is a possible line of inquiry for you with your doctor. The third important discovery is that there is a third type of SIBO. So for the last number of years, practitioners have been looking for two different types of SIBO, hydrogen SIBO or methane SIBO, which are documented using a lactulose or glucose breath test done at home or in a lab. However, sometimes patients would be negative on both of these tests, but still have evidence of diarrhea type IBS, and there wouldn't be any clear indicators of what exactly was going on. And this might even be true after ruling out all the other obvious possible options. So Dr. Pimentel's team documented a third type of SIBO called hydrogen sulfide SIBO, which is caused by an elevation of hydrogen sulfide gas. And hydrogen sulfide, when elevated in the gut, can cause a lot of abdominal pain and diarrhea. And they found that levels of this gas on a SIBO test definitely correlate with the severity of symptoms. So when it comes to methane SIBO, the team has clarified that an excess of methane gas means that there are organisms called archaea, which are kind of older than bacteria. They're not exactly bacteria. And those are the organisms that are responsible for the methane gas production. And because of this, they're now calling methane SIBO intestinal methanogen overgrowth, or IMO. It's still SIBO, but it's just slightly different. It's clarifying who's causing the problem. And then finally, of course, hydrogen SIBO is the other option. Hydrogen's been a little confusing because it doesn't really seem to correlate with symptom severity. In other words, the higher the hydrogen, you don't have worse symptoms. What the team has clarified is that the hydrogen sulfide SIBO and the intestinal methanogen overgrowth actually thrive on the hydrogen. And the hydrogen is used as a food source for the organisms that are producing these other gases. So that's partly why hydrogen elevations can be a sign of other problems, but they don't directly correlate with symptoms specifically. So what does all this mean for you? Well, basically, it's really important to know which specific type of SIBO that you have because the treatment approaches and protocols are different depending on which specific problem you have. And so Dr. Pimentel's team has developed a new SIBO test called the TrioSmart test, which actually tests for all three gases in one test. Unfortunately, this test isn't yet widely used. We're still relying often on the test that just looks for hydrogen and methane, but I think eventually practitioners will be using this test that looks at all three gases because it gives a much more complete picture of what's happening in the small intestine and what we need to do to address it. Have you ever tested for SIBO? Tell me about it in the comments. Okay, discovery number four from Dr. Pimentel's team is that Dr. Pimentel at this point estimates that approximately 60% of IBS cases are caused by SIBO specifically. So I regularly hear from people whose practitioners aren't willing to test them for SIBO or who tell them that, you know, SIBO is not really a real thing. That's all just BS. And these are the same practitioners who are then willing to diagnose these people with IBS, which is really just an umbrella term that means that they've had abdominal pain and bowel changes for several months in a row. In many cases, it's not very helpful. One of the most exciting and vindicating things that Dr. Pimentel has determined from his research is that, again, 60% or so of IBS cases are actually directly caused by SIBO. And he says that there are 25 separate peer-reviewed studies out there that show that breath tests are more often positive in IBS patients. Now, IBS, of course, is quite common, and there are lots of different possible reasons for it. But up until now, there hasn't really been much meaningful dialogue about the possible underlying causes or what to do about it. You know, and doctors often conclude that, oh, it's really just a problem with your stress, or the more enlightened doctors might say that, oh, it's related to your diet and you can alter it depending on what you eat. But with the clarity that up to 60% of IBS cases are caused by a specific type of bacterial overgrowth, and that food poisoning is a specific trigger for many of these cases of IBS. Not only is IBS something that's not being imagined by patients, it's also something that can be directly treated, which is a really wonderful piece of news for a significant portion of IBS patients. So discovery number five is something that I found very surprising, and I think you will too, and it's that you should not supplement with betaine HCl or other stomach acid supports if you have SIBO. This really surprised me, but Dr. Pimentel reported that these items, betaine, HCl, lemon juice, and apple cider vinegar, you know, vinegars per se, can worsen SIBO symptoms. And he was saying that earlier, people suspected that PPI use, so proton pump inhibitors or acid-reducing medications, would be a risk factor for SIBO because they would reduce the stomach acid that's kind of our first line of defense against incoming bacteria. And this was kind of operating under the assumption that SIBO was caused by ingesting bad bacteria. And now we know that it sort of is, but indirectly, right? But anyways, he found the opposite, that people who were on PPI medication actually have lower rates of SIBO than people who do not use PPI medication. And he also commented that he's heard from several of his patients that felt worse when using stomach acid supports. Apparently, the betaine HCl and the vinegars provide food and stimulation for the hydrogen-producing bacteria, and this makes more food for the methanogens or the hydrogen sulfide SIBO that might be present. So this is just a little bit surprising because as a health coach, I was trained to support people's stomach acid as a way to encourage healthy digestion. But the long and the short of this is that you want to wait to support that stomach acid function until you've cleared SIBO. And if you suspect you might have SIBO, you might want to hold off on that until you confirm that you have it or not. And this is a really good reminder that we always want to customize our approach to things and not just use blanket protocols or recommendations because they may not be right for us. And we have to understand what those tools are trying to do for us and whether or not they're right for us before we experiment with them. Do you need help figuring out whether you have SIBO or how to manage it? Helping clients with SIBO is just one of the many ways that I help my clients inside the Calm Digestion Method, which is a new online program that I'm offering. Doors are currently open for the Calm Digestion Method, and if you're interested or you think I might be able to help you, I'd like to invite you to apply for a seat in the program by scheduling a free 45-minute discovery call with me. I will leave a link for you below this video for where to schedule that, but you can head over to confluencenutrition.com/contact and pick a time that works for you, and I will look forward to meeting with you to figure out how we can help get you feeling better. If you like this video, please click like and consider subscribing and go ahead and share it with someone who you think might also benefit from it. And I've also left you a few particular videos here that might be helpful for you, so go ahead and check those out too, and I look forward to seeing you next time.